we have already watched a video about what is equator, what is ecliptic, but it will be a good idea to revise it quickly. As you already know, equator, celestial equator, is projection of Earth's equator on the celestial sphere. And ecliptic is the apparent path of sun as we see from Earth. We can visualize that on the sky. Suppose if the observer is at the center of the Earth, what we call a geocentric position, then on the celestial sphere, he or she will see that this is like a celestial sphere with gray lines. The dark black line is the celestial equator, and the red line is the ecliptic. And as you would recall, the crossing points are called vernal equinox and autumnal equinox. And at summer solstice, ecliptic is way higher than the equator, and winter solstice it is way below. The inclination between these two circles is roughly 23.5 degrees. It keeps changing slightly over the centuries. Presently it is about 23.43 degrees. Now, going up a step beyond, we always encounter another word which we call as meridian. Meridian in common geography also it is used. For example, you have heard of Greenwich Meridian. Greenwich Meridian is a semicircular arc which passes through both Earth's pole and the town of Greenwich. And that is our reference longitude for calculating all the longitudes. So meridian is a general term of a circle for many practical purposes, semicircle, which passes through both poles of that given sphere. And it is centered at the origin of the sphere. So it is kind of not just any type of circle, but it is a circle which passes through both poles and centered at the origin. Now, why we need to define this meridian? Because for an observer on Earth, when we are observing the sky, even for our local environment, we can define a meridian. For our local environment, we can see there is north direction, there is south direction, and then I can say there is a semicircular arc which will pass from north, go up all the way up to my overhead point, and then go towards south. This will be my local meridian. Now I set a point directly above my head. This point here marked with this blue arrow going up, this is called the zenith point of that observer. And opposite of that, if the observer looks below, I suppose the Earth is completely transparent, let's say, the observer will be able to see through the Earth, all the way behind the Earth, and that point exactly below your feet will be Nadir, which will be like showing there. And meridian shown here is north to south, passing through zenith. Here the green line shows the horizon for the observer. So formally, zenith is the highest point for that observer, as seen in the local sky, which is exactly overhead. Nadir is exactly the point which is diametrically opposite to that on the celestial sphere. North celestial pole, NCP, is the point along which the axis of rotational axis of Earth points. Okay, so you can say northern point along a diameter which is perpendicular to the equatorial plane. So if you take the plane of equator, draw a diameter which is perpendicular to that plane, then the northern end of that point will point to north celestial pole. Like we have north celestial pole, there will be south celestial pole. And like in case of equator, we define this north and south celestial poles. If you take ecliptic, which is inclined to equator, similarly we can define north ecliptic pole and south ecliptic pole. Now, in all this, I am not mentioning any star. We are used to saying Polaris is a north star, Polaris is a star which doesn't move from north. But remember, we live in some duration of centuries where there is a bright star very close to the north celestial pole. North celestial pole is a point on our coordinate grid. It has nothing to do with stars. Because Polaris is there very close to it, we can use it as an easy reference. There have been centuries in the past where no such star was there. Even today, if you go to the southern hemisphere, there is no good point reference star close to South Celestial Pole. So having the star close to pole is not necessary. So when we are talking about coordinates, we should always talk NCP and SCP, never talk in terms of polarity. Local meridian, as I already mentioned, is a circle which passes through the North Celestial Pole, Zenith, South Celestial Pole and Nadir, full circle. For practical purposes, when we talk about meridian, local meridian, we talk about only the part which is visible above horizon for us. We ignore the part which is below horizon. But remember, meridian is a full circle. Then we define something called culmination. Culmination is the instance when the star crosses the local meridian in the upper arc. What I mean by upper arc, we can define, as I said, meridian is a full circle. You can divide in two parts. And the cut will be along the North Celestial Pole and South Celestial Pole. So they will be on the cut. So one side of the arc will include Zenith. Other side, semicircle, will include Nadir. So I will take the part which includes Zenith as the upper arc and part which includes Nadir as the lower arc. So when a star crosses meridian in the upper arc, we say that it is culminating for that observer. Since the meridian is defined locally, the culmination is also a local event. And then we define something called hour angle, which is very commonly used in positional astronomy. Hour angle just tells you, although it's angle, it gives you time since the last culmination of that star. So if I say hour angle of the sun is 2 hours, it means that sun was at the local meridian 2 hours back. If I say hour angle of sun is minus 3 hours or 21 hours, then that means sun will come to meridian after 3 more hours. With that, we come to the definition of day. There are at least two definitions which are very commonly used in astronomy. First, we define something called solar day. Solar day is time between two successive culminations of the sun. The slide says mean sun, that is for a technical reason which we will cover in another video. But for practical purposes, let's say two successive culminations of sun. Now remember, when the sun is at the meridian, it is at its highest point for that day, which means when sun is at meridian, that is the local noon. So we can alternately define solar day as time between two successive noons for that place. And traditionally, by definition, we say this time is 24 hours. That is how our clocks were designed. People watched when the solar noon happens, and time between that, they calibrated as 24 hours. But there is another way of defining the day, what we call as the sidereal day. What is sidereal day? Sidereal day is time between two successive culminations of any distant star. First definition, we had time between two successive culminations of sun. Second day, time between two successive culminations of stars. They look very similar. So what has changed? This fact which has changed is stars are very, very far and sun is not that far. It is far, but not that far. So what is the difference? Let's take this example. There is an observer here on Earth, and what is the observer? Sun is at the meridian, so in a 2D projection it will appear as if sun is overhead, but technically let's say sun is at meridian, and behind sun, far far away, there is some star which is our reference star. Earth is going around sun in this way, this direction, and Earth is rotating all in this direction. Now Earth keeps rotating and it also keeps going around sun slowly let's see what happens after one full rotation. One full Earth rotation is when we again get this line which is parallel to this line. These two lines are parallel, and at that time, that distance, which is practically an infinite distance, will be again on your meridian. The star will be culminating again. So the sidereal day will give you the rotation period of Earth. But here you can see on the diagram the problem which has occurred. Because Earth has moved in its orbit, now Sun is no longer on your meridian. Here the diagram is a bit exaggerated, but that will give you a good idea. Now what has to happen for Sun to come back to meridian? Remember, Earth is rotating this way. So Earth has to rotate slightly more so that this observer has to turn, and then the line going through that observer will reach Sun. How much more is the question. Now, what we realize that Earth goes around Sun in about 365 days and a circle has 360 degrees. So roughly you can say Earth goes around Sun on average, we are assuming circular orbit of Earth for simplification, on average we can say Earth moves in the orbit by about 1 degree per day. So we can say angle between this position and this position is 1 degree. Since these two lines are parallel, that also means this angle is 1 degree. Which means this observer on Earth, that position has to rotate by 1 degree more for Sun to culminate. Now, how to use that? So, when 360 degrees got completed, we got one sidereal day finished. But to complete one solar day, we need to do one additional degree of rotation. So 361 degrees. If you use that, you will realize that sidereal day length will be just 360 by 361 into solar day length, and solar day length we define as 24 hours. If you substitute these numbers, you will get roughly the answer as 23 degrees hours 56 minutes 1 second. If you want to do even more precise calculation, you can either say, oh, it is not 1 degree, it is slightly less than 1 degree because it is 365 days. We are still talking circular orbit, we are not talking about elliptic orbit at all. Or this is another way of doing it. What you can do, remember here, we have to, Earth has to rotate 1 degree more in 1 day. Then another degree more on 2nd day. Another degree more on 3rd day. Doing this, by the time Earth completes one full revolution around Sun, Earth will also complete one extra rotation. So in one full revolution period of Earth, number of sidereal days will be one more than number of solar days. So if we use that, in one revolution period of Earth, there are 365.2563 solar days. But number of sidereal days should be one extra, so 366.2563, and multiplied by T solar, calculate, you get 23 hours, 56 minutes, 4.1 seconds. This is closer, almost equal to the actual rotation period of Earth. You can do more precise calculation and you can get slightly better answers. Now, in this, please remember we have assumed, and which is actually true, that Earth rotation and revolution both are happening in same direction. At the close of this video, I want you to think about what will happen, what would have happened if Earth's rotation was in the opposite direction. How the sidereal day would have changed and how solar day would have changed. Would they change or would they not change? Think about this. And if they are changing, what would be the new length? Calculate and do share your answers.